go back to the world of vice and shame. This portrays Israel forsaking Christ. After some time, possibly several years, the Lord told
him
to go and purchase Gomer, for she was now to be sold as a slave. So he purchased her off the auction block.
Thank you, Pastor Donnie.
Thrown to the street. One child left in the hospital. Grandma picked him up for the dope money. And that's all. In a place to stay. They still can't make a home. But got a dope spot. A den of iniquity. From upstairs is not. From one generation to the next. So I'm usually coming over not. Just damned. Unredeemed. Lost. Sin running rampant. by choice. And look at this, I'm on TV. And what you hear is a little thing. Shit from the hell. Grandma gotta get high and evil. And she did all type of dope. Smoke, snort, chihuahua. Grandma. That's Leona. She apartment D. Wobble wobble can't wash. And wash mean to wash the body. Well, that's no body, but okay. But she go get that dope, don't she, Laurie? And come back, drop, throw down, stone. And little badass boy did too. She saw him. He know what shoe to use. And I believe it was that white tennis shoe. Throw it down, wherever you can. And he get high with her too. And the woman in the gray car. She was here last night. He left out this morning. The video of them. What's up? She's foolishness. Lord Jesus, thank you.
The three greatest antagonists to the child of God are the world, the flesh, and the devil. Christians try to fight these enemies on their own, only to experience continual discouragement and failure. In this compelling book, Evangelist Jimmy Spire illustrates how the Holy Spirit works within the parameters of the finished work of Christ to help Christians maintain faith in the cross where Satan was defeated. The word of this book, the flesh and the devil, go to shopjsm.org.
who should have to live like this. They don't need to be moved, they need to be put out. They telling you that. And showing you.
Listening for your call.
jsn.org. This is Gabriel Spivey, president of Jimmy Spivey Bible College. For over 30 years, JSBC is preparing students for ministry, whether it's pastors or teachers. With the Word of God as the cornerstone of our curriculum, we are preparing students for lifelong experiences. I can promise every prospective student a well-rounded education on this beautiful campus where people are respected and true Christian faith in practice. As the grandson of Evangelist Jimmy Spivey, I can assure you that your time spent here will result in three things. Number one, an understanding of the message of Jesus Christ and the crucified. Number two, what it means to be thoroughly Pentecostal. And number three, how to apply the Word of God to your everyday life.
Jimmy Spivey Bible College, spiritually minded, academically sound. Every Christian will find themselves facing sin in some form. When failure enters their life, they become discouraged and resort to other means of trying to find victory, all of which lead to failure. The Yoke of Bondage, written by Evangelist Jimmy Spivey, will open the eyes of the reader, revealing that victory is only found in Jesus Christ and his finished work at the cross. To order your copy of The Yoke of Bondage, go to shopjsn.org. Taking the message of the cross to the world. This is the Sunlight Broadcasting Network. Welcome to the live service of Family Worship Center. The service is also being broadcast live on Sunlight Radio, online worldwide at sunlighttv.com, and on the free SBN Now app. We'll have praise and worship from the Family Worship Center singers and musicians, a time for prayer, and the anointed preaching from God's Word. Now, let's go live to the Family Worship Center sanctuary as the service begins.
service from Family Worship Center. Aren't we glad tonight to have Brother Tommy Bates back with us? And also his son, Dr. Eric Bates. Eric, would you stand? Eric is a great guy. And we've become very, very good friends in the last couple of years, and we appreciate this entire family. There's going to be a Crossfire volunteer meeting for the upcoming Crossfire. Is that the weekend coming up? Now, the retreat, not the camp coming up, but the Crossfire retreat. So if you're volunteering, that is going to be after the service in the choir room, directly behind us. And then Monday, June the 3rd, will be the June Bible Bond. We're going to be starting with the finishing off the country of Zambia, then Nigeria, and then this is beautiful, this is wonderful. When we finish that, hopefully we'll finish those two countries, and then we'll be starting on the next country, will be the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Yeah, that's good, but this is better. It's a French-speaking country. We'll be introducing the brand new French version of the Expositor Study Bible. I wish I had one here to hold up, but it's actually being printed right now. And this is the first time that when we start on Congo, this will be the first time that we not only introduced the new Bible, but it was being printed while we're introducing, so it will go from us introducing it and offering it to being printed and shipped out for distribution in the Congo. And I had the privilege of preaching in the capital city, Kinshasa, years ago, and in a wonderful church, a large church. And then after Congo, the next country, and it will probably be the next month in July, but it's France.
Good to see you, man.
And then Gabon, which is another French-speaking country in Africa. Man, aren't you excited what the Lord is doing in these doors that He is opening up? And, will be finished. We've already finished the New Testament. Permission. They wanted us to do the New Testament first. And so we've already finished that. We'll be printing that and distributing those out. And then we'll be going with the regular Bible. And at the same time, we're also far along on the translation for the Hmong language. And we'll be distributing those out in different parts of Vietnam, Cambodia, for the Hmong people. And the Hmong people are the mountain people of Vietnam. They're spread out over Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos. During the Vietnam War, they fought on the side of the United States. And they've been very, since the war, they've been very, very mistreated. And you don't find them in the cities. They are the mountain people. But in the last 3 years, Brother Dave Reaver has shared this before, but I'll remind you if you didn't hear it. A great move of God has broken out in the mountains of Vietnam among the Hmong people. And they don't really have churches. And that's how we got involved in this. He came and visited us about 3 years ago and asked if we would be interested in translating the Bible in Vietnamese and in the Hmong. And normally, the policy, we wouldn't do that normally because it has a very limited, like you try to do languages that reach around the world. You understand what I'm talking about?
Yes, sir.
And it's very hard to do all of the work and the labor for a small country. But when we sat down and started talking, he didn't have to finish. In about 30 seconds, both Dad and I were going, yeah, we'll do it. We'll do it. We thank the Lord for that. And by the way, for you don't know, we have helped Brother Reaver build a school there. And a church and a school to reach out and do some things. We thank the Lord for that. And And then JSM International Youth Conference, July the 24th through the 28th. The first volunteer meeting will be held Tuesday, June the 4th at 6 p.m. in the Crossfire Auditorium. And for those of you watching, youth pastors, youth groups, you need to make your plans to be at this great conference. It's a kids conference slash youth conference. So we want them from 5 to 6 years old all the way up. And so we want you to be here. And then JSM Summer Intensives, June the 10th through the 14th. Dr. Dave Watts will be teaching a great class on how to study the Bible. And I would encourage all of you to come and be a part of this. You don't have to be a preacher for this or a minister. Every person needs to know how to properly study the Word of God. And then July the 8th through the 12th will be our last class. Dr. Jimmy Dupree will be teaching Intro to Christian Ministry. Then next Wednesday night, Gabe, for the month of June, will be ministering a series entitled The Miracles of Jesus Christ. And that's going to be dynamic. We're going to be praying for the sick. We're going to be believing God for miracles.
Yeah.
We're going to be believing God to touch you. I believe the Lord has spoken to my heart on more than one occasion that in these last days, the television audience, you listen to me, I believe we're going to see a move of God in the realm of divine healing like we've never seen before. I believe that. I believe the Lord has spoken that into my heart. I'm not a prophet, and I'm not saying emphatically the Lord said that, but I felt impressed on more than one occasion what the Lord speaking that to my heart. And so you need to be in these services, and as well, get your prayer request in. Get your prayer request in. We'll be believing God for your miracles. I want to thank each and every one of you for continuing to pray for Dad. He's at home, of course, and Gable is there with him tonight, but he is doing well, and he's today. There was a big jump in his improvement, a big jump. And 2 days ago, you know, Jennifer flew in, Matthew drove in with Ryder, our grandson. We all came together as a family to help and to do what we could. And Matthew and I were we were at the house. Mother and Dad were sitting in their easy chairs and they had dozed off. And all of a sudden, Dad was sound asleep. But all of a sudden, in his sleep, he started praying.
I believe that.
Out loud. And I mean, the presence of God came into that house, and he was praying, and it's embellished on my mind. All they just said, Lord, thank you for the cross. Help me to keep my faith in the finished work of Calvary. Help me to keep my eyes upon Calvary. Everything that we have comes through Calvary. All of the victory that you've given to the church comes through Calvary. And then he went in, Lord, we need the Holy Spirit. We've got to have the anointing of the Holy Spirit. What you have called us to do, we can't do it without the Holy Spirit. Then he went back to sleep. Just stop praying. But I'm telling, when he started, Matthew was on one couch, I was on the other. I had tears coming down my cheek, and Matthew was sitting there with a big smile on his face, and he told me later, he said, that was unbelievable. Unbelievable. But that shows
you. No, we know we're talking about, Lord, don't we?
Thank you. His mind is
right
on the things of God. But we thank you for praying, and he's, like I said, he's making great improvement. And it's going to be a little while yet, but he'll be back. And the other day he said, man, I miss church.
He got it on.
Wouldn't have made it.
But I know what he did.
I could have tried. I said, no. That's his life. Why don't you stand tonight as we receive our tithe and offering for our church. And then after the service, we'll be receiving a very special offering for Pastor Bates. Father, we come before you in the name of your Son, Jesus. Lord, we are so grateful to serve you. We're so grateful that you are our Lord and our Savior. Lord, receive the gifts of our finances tonight. They're gifts of love. And bless each and every one. And Lord, we pray for our television audience. Whatever the need of their life, whatever the need of their family is, I'm asking that your grace would begin to flow in their lives to meet those needs. And we give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Roger, you're out and drop in your gifts.
Well, we learned, don't we, Lord?
Thank you.
I've got Jesus on my mind. Lord, thank you. Got him on my mind.
Oh, no.
occupation.
Thank you. No more darkness, no more night.
Prayer. Our text is found in Psalms 141, verses 1 and 2.
I would like to illustrate, you know, a lot of times we talk about prayer, and people look at prayer in many different ways. Some of them look at it as a militant action, and they look at it as some duty. They look at it as some very difficult task, but I'd like to show it to you just a little bit in a different way, the way the Lord sort of helped me. And you know, when you're conceived in your mother's womb, as that little baby in your mother's womb, you're floating around in the embryonic fluid, having a wonderful time, having a good time. There's an umbilical cord that you're hooked up to. That's where you're getting all the oxygen. And you're getting hot meals, and in Kentucky, you'd be getting chicken and dumplings on the neck bone, and mustard greens, you'd be getting fried chicken, you'd be getting baked chicken, you'd be getting boiled chicken, you'd be getting chicken, and more chicken. And you'd be eating green beans, shucked beans, lima beans, green peas, you name it, and hot meals coming down the umbilical cord. But it, after the gestation period has come to its finality, and it's time for you to be pushed into this world. Of course, the babe don't want to be here, but the babe has to be pushed. The babe enters into another world, still hooked up to that old life, but enters into this new world. And then they take the umbilical cord and they clamp it. When they clamp that umbilical cord, there is something in the human mind, in the brain, a mechanism that says you're not going to breathe out of that cord anymore. You're not going to breathe out of it. You're going to have to breathe a different way. That's what you got that nose for. That's what you got that mouth for. You're not going to be breathing out of the navel anymore. And the old is clamped off. And all it wants,
Lord, thank you.
Well, most of the time, the baby is there is a need for air, but not sure how to get it.
And same for what they are.
Sometimes they used to, when I was coming to this world, just hold them upside down and sort of spank them on the backside. But you can't do that anymore. That could be like child abuse or something. So they do things a little more professional. But you begin to breathe a different air. And then about a little bit of time passes by, and that baby says, where in the world is that smoked macaroni and mustard greens? Where's that macaroni and cheese? What happened to the chicken and dumplings around here? I'm hungry. There's another mechanism that triggers in the back brain, and that little babe don't even know, but the mouth that has never been used starts to draw. It starts to draw. And in the days before there was bottles and things, the only way that babe would survive is going to back to the mother who gave that babe life. And that's the way I see prayer. Prayer is I've come to this morning and experienced. I know that this old life has been cut off. I'm no longer breathing air of this old world system. I'm breathing the air of the Spirit. And I've got a hunger now that this world cannot satisfy. This world cannot satisfy the nutrition that I need. So I must be drawn to the One. That's why the Bible said, as babes in Christ, desire ye the sincere milk of the Word, that you may grow thereby. So prayer, I want you to see a visual, is your connection to your God, the One who gave you life. It's not this kind of a task that's, you know, that you're a burden of some kind, or you watch the clock and you're looking at it, seeing how much time you can put in, and just see how much you can suffer. While you pray, suffer a lot, then God's going to hear you better. But it's a mechanism of development. It's God who gave me life. And I, as much as I do believe in the foundation of the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ, but if something would happen and you would be in a nation where you didn't have a beautiful church building as we have, you didn't have all of the nice things, you would have to continue your life by drawing life from Him. You couldn't come to a place of worship. It would have to be solely into Christ. Now the word prayer, there are so many different kinds in the Word of God. I'm going to mention first of all the silent prayer. Silent prayer is when you cannot say it out loud. And I've been in situations where it was an impossibility. I got my bachelor's and master's in education. I taught the sixth grade for 4 years. And there were many times in difficult situations with young people, children in the middle school area, that had very difficult problems, some very situations that I don't want to get into right now, but I want you to know that they called for prayer. They called for prayer. It seemed like when the burden got heavy, I would have to step into another room and just sort of silently call upon the name of the Lord.
That's right.
I was a young pastor, about 25 years old, and we got a phone call from Brother Harley Hickson, one of the great elderly men of the Appalachian Mountains. He lived up north where we live. And a pastor by the name of Brother Taylor. His boy was 15 years old and was running his four-wheeler, and he went too far off of the gravel driveway, was hit by a vehicle, and when they called, they said the boy is basically dead. They got him on machines to keep him alive so the family could all come in, say their goodbyes, and make the funeral arrangements. And so they called for Brother Hensley to come, and he called for me to ride with him. And when we got there, of course, that was the report. He's brain dead. He has no activity. We're just waiting for all the family to get in and say their goodbyes. It was in a place where we could not do our, you know, that Pentecostal praying that happens sometimes. And where you know, you don't have to scream at God, by the way.
No.
But when your emotions and your feelings just pour out to God. This was a place we couldn't do it. And I remember Brother Harley Hensley there at that moment. I was standing next to his side. All at once, under his breath, I could barely hear him whisper. He said, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I could barely hear him, and I was standing right next to him. He took his finger and touched that boy's forehead. I'm an eyewitness. The moment he did, the boy jerked as if an electric shock went through his body. All the machines began to go off. The nurses and the doctors come running in. What's happened? And we said, simply just said, we don't know. You check him yourself. And I want to give you a report that boy not only came out of there, but I believe he had three or four children. They've already graduated from high school. And how that God honors silent prayer. We know this in the scripture by the prayer of Hannah. It is silent prayer. And then there's intercessory prayer. This is prayer like that Abraham had when his nephew Lot was down in Sodom. And Abraham began to intercede, intercessory prayer, standing in the gap for someone else. While he was standing in the gap, we see in the scripture that even though Lot really wasn't too enthused about leaving Sodom, that God sent angels that were dispatched. And even when Lot was not ready to leave, those angels took him by the hand and got him out of there. Then there's prayers and petition. This is prayers that are said in order like Esther. It's a request unto the Lord. Now, if I die, I'm going to die, but we've got to have a move. This is the prayer of petition. Then there's the prayer of supplication. Prayer of supplication simply means to supply a need. But if you look into the original writing of supplication, it means you have presented yourself not as a beggar, but as having nothing. I can't do it without you. There is no other answer but you. I've exhausted all of my resources. If you don't help me, I will die. I cannot, there is nothing else to help. That is the prayer of supplication. Now, I know there's times you can't pray out loud. I've told you that. But according to the Word of God, and according to the Bible said this gospel came to the Jew first and then to the Greek, the Gentile. The Jewish people have taught us there is something that happens when you begin to pray out loud. You don't have to scream to God, but there is something that happens in the atmosphere. We understand that Satan himself is not omniscient. You begin to pray, and he hears the word of the Lord coming out of your mouth.
Again.
And he must submit to the words that are being said. He's got to back off. Because your mouth is executing the will of God. Kingdom of God come. Will of God be done in earth as it is in heaven. We know that angels excel in strength and they hearken unto the word of the Lord. But they are not omniscient either. they hearken unto the word of the Lord. So when you pray out loud, not only does it put Satan in submission to the word of God, but when you pray out loud, it causes angels to be dispatched. And then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. You begin to pray out loud, there is something that happens in you. You begin to hear yourself say things. And thou, O Lord, art a shield for me. You're the glory. You're the lifter up of my head. Though I be circled around with thousands around me, yet I will not fear. For the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? You begin to pray and say, He's my rock. Hallelujah. You begin to cry out unto the Lord. Hear my cry, O Lord. Incline unto my voice. From the ends of the earth will I cry unto thee. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to that rock that is higher than I. I'm telling you, when you begin to pray out loud, and you begin to pray the word of God, the Spirit of the living God, the Holy Ghost, He begins to rise up inside of you. There is a supernatural strength that comes within you. And so as we see these prayers, there's still yet another one besides the silent prayer, the intercessory prayer, the prayer of supplication, the prayer of petition. In the book Psalms 131, said, let my prayer go forth as incense. That word prayer is a different word. Those other words of prayer are palah. That's the Hebrew word. It's the all-inclusive word for prayer. Palah. But when you get to Psalms 141, that word is tefillah. And it's a prayer that gets so intense. It is a prayer that gets so, your spirit, soul, and body gets so involved in this prayer that it turns into almost, it sounds like a song. It sounds like a hymn because it's coming from the depths of your soul. You see, music is the language of the soul. I can hum a tune right now. And if I started humming a tune, you would get, your emotions would get involved in it. Your soul is your will, your mind, and your emotions. Just the music alone will put your soul into some type of an experience. And so this tefillah prayer, T-E-P-H-I-L-L-A-H, It's the kind of prayer that gets so intense that it sounds like a song. And I'm going to have to illustrate this a little bit to you. If you go to Israel, you go to the Western Wall, you will watch the ancient Jewish people rock back and forth and rock side by side. This is not just something they've learned in the last few thousand years. This has come to them from Adam, Noah, all the way to Job to Moses. Psalms chapter 90 says the prayer of Moses, it's the tefillah. It's this intense prayer. And if I was to pray Psalms chapter 3 in a Hebrew type culture, it would sound something like this.
Holy Spirit, you you have the table of shewbread, which represents the living word and the written word. But before you get into that place, that dimension of that tabernacle, where the Ark of the Covenant was, where the supernatural power of God was released, until before you can go to that place, there was a place called the altar of incense. They took gold made of stacked and honica, these three spices, and they beat them very fine, and they mixed them with pure frankincense. I don't have time to go into the entire study, but that's my spirit, soul, and body, which is beaten very small, and it's beaten very small, and it's mixed with frankincense, which represents the very spirit of Christ himself. And with this incense, it was made a cloud in that tabernacle. It made a cloud, and that was a prerequisite before the high priest could go in and sprinkle the blood on the mercy seat, and the glory would be released. And as we see this, he said, let my prayer, my spirit, my soul, and my body fused with the Holy Spirit, let it come before your presence as a cloud, as incense that goes to heaven. Let it come before your presence. Now, I'm not from the Hebrew culture. I'm not from the Middle East. I'm from the Appalachian culture, which is the Scotch and the Irish, who married with the Native Americans and the African people, and they developed their own sound. So if I was to pray, and this is what I've heard all of my life, and I thought it was just a cultural thing. I thought it was just us. It was just something that I'd heard the old regular Baptist pray, and the Church of Christ pray, and the holiness, and those in the Appalachian Mountains. But it has a sound. If you were to hear it in Appalachian culture, it would sound like this. How are they increased that trouble me? Against me, many there be which say of my soul, there is no help for you in God. But I cried unto the Lord with my voice, and he heard me out of his holy hill. When I first started preaching as a teenager in the Appalachian Mountains, I stayed with the elderly people, and they told me that during World War II,
Lord,
that the mountains
had
a smokehouse, and behind the barn, and down by the creek, and in the middle of the cornfield, that you could hear these people with this call, this cry, this kind of praying that goes beyond words. The Bible said the groaning of the words of my groaning. There's some times that you can pray and you don't even have the words to say, and it comes out almost as a groan of the spirit. It comes out as a groan on the inside. And all of the older people told me, when they're boys, those teenage boys in Appalachia with the bib overalls on and no shirts and barefoot, when they got on those buses to go to enlist for World War II, that those fathers went out in the cornfield, the mothers from behind the barns, they went out in the field, and they would tell me, everyone I stayed with, whether they was an old regular Baptist, whether they were a Church of Christ, whether they were a Pentecostal or a Holiness or a Church of God or Assembly of God, it didn't make any difference. They began to cry with such intensity, with such soul crying out, oh God, bring my boy home. Oh, bring my boy home, oh Lord. They said you could hear it across the mountains. You could hear that sound of the intensity of prayer. Back when our church was founded, a woman had a vision, and she came to Northern Kentucky. My grandfather was a backslider. He was drinking and carrying on, knew better than that. He had 16 brothers and sisters, but God sent a woman in our house, at my grandfather's house. She knocked on the door. She had driven all the way from the Appalachian Mountains, 4 or 5 hour drive, and said, God has sent me here, told her what road to go on, sent her to that house, and in that prayer meeting,
voluntary and gave their heart to the Lord. Brett Paul bought a tent. It was set up on Route 16. People didn't understand what was going on. Who are these people playing these guitars and beating tambourines and cymbals? And this tent was full. In the winter time, as they got cool, and they went to a chicken house, whitewashed it out, and they were having church in the chicken house. And from the chicken house, they went to the barn. And that's where Dad prayed through to salvation, was when the church was in the barn. He said, if that old preacher comes back here, I'm gonna hit him. I'm gonna knock him out. Because his grandma told him, she said, Tommy, you stay away from those people. They've got spook dust. And if they put the spook dust on you, you end up just like them. Look what they've done to Janice. They put spook dust on her. You can't even do anything with her. She's down there among those holy rollers. She's playing a guitar. She grew this long hair out. And now she's singing crazy songs like fire. Oh, fire. Shut up in my bones. You don't want that, Tommy. So Dad was sitting in the back when the church was in the barn. The old preacher came back. He was walking the aisles with his long sleeves. Sinner boy, you need to pray. Oh, son, don't let your life be taken out until you find this great salvation. Dad said he knew that he couldn't hit the old man, so he jumped up, went to take his foot to kick the door of the barn. And when he went to kick the door of the barn, the spook dust hit him. Hallelujah. He said, I fell to my knees. I crawled all the way on sawdust, all the way to that altar. And 1 hour later, I was rolling all over the sawdust, saying, I've got it. I've got it. I've got it. I've got it. Hallelujah. I said, hallelujah. Well, the church had finally bought a piece of property, and they had built a basement. They were so poor, they didn't have enough money to put a roof on it. So they covered it with plywood and put tar paper. They were Appalachian migrants just south of Cincinnati in northern Kentucky. Poor people, laughed at, had a different accent. Oh, the church, the pastor got, he got a little discouraged. He said, I can't take it. My nerves are shot. And he walked away from the church, a church full of people. And my mom told my daddy, she said, Tom, you're going to have to go to my grandmother's and get my cousin Chester. He's come home from the military. He's been saved. He's full of the fire of God. He's preaching, and God is using him. And Dad had a 1951 Lincoln. He made his way to my great-grandmother's, about a four-hour drive. Now, when he got there, it was a typical end of the day. They were all sitting on the porch. My great-grandmother, Aunt Helen, Aunt Martha, Aunt Maud, Aunt Stella, but all grandpa had 16 brothers and sisters, and they'd come and see Mommy. As many as were in the local area, they'd see Mommy every evening. Dad pulls up in that 1951 Lincoln, and when he pulls up, everybody's heart's panicking. There were no phones, no way to get a hold of anybody. They even start crying. Oh, something's happened. Tommy's gonna tell us that something bad has happened. And they said, Tommy, what's going on? What has happened? He said, Janice sent me up here. Said the church is in trouble. And she said, we need to find Chester. And I need to go find Chester to bring him to Kentucky. She said, he's got the power that he can pull us through this. They said, oh, honey, he just moved last week. He's 14 miles away. And none of us have ever been there. And we don't know where he lives. We have no idea. Remember, no phones. And Dad went to walk away. But about that time, Aunt Helen, who was a prayer warrior, who knew how to get a hold of God, didn't have nothing but a second grade education.
Leave, Martha.
She called Jeremiah Jerrymar. And from the word here, she said, here. And from the word said, bar. I mean, she was Appalachian from head to toe. Didn't have a lot of education, but had great power with God. She said, Tommy, you do the driving, and I'll do the praying. Dad was still a good little Baptist boy. He was saved in the Holiness Church, but did not receive the baptism in the Holy Ghost. He said, I got in the car, and all at once, she started that tefillah prayer.
Lord, that's a good one.
With God that you call upon the Lord.
Come on,
tonight,
tell you, I said, you're talented. You've got this and you've got the no. I'm here because 52 years ago, I knew how to get hooked up. I said, I knew how to get hooked up. I got hooked up. And people say,
how did
you end up in that big church down there with Brother Slacker? It was the weirdest thing. I was praying.
That's it.
The Lord said, must go to Baton Rouge and give honor to Jimmy Slacker. The gospel and the baptism in the Holy Ghost. And I'll end on the world's television screen. Against all and everyone's opinion, he did it anyway. So,
we need it back.
Thank you. Hallelujah. So I'm a nobody from nowhere. Independence, Kentucky has had a little a little bit of television, but in comparison to all this kind of stuff. So how's this gonna happen? The like Mary, how's this gonna happen? How in the world is this going to happen, okay? Well, I'm not going to tell the whole story. All I can tell you is Father Bill Bailey said, I've got a Southern Gospel event coming on, and I'm having lunch with Brother Cedric Swagger, and they said I could have a guest. I hope they said that. I believe you thought they said it. He said, I'm allowed to have a guest. So I'll bring you with me. I thought, okay, I'm in now. All I want to say is thank you. I bought a plane ticket, a hotel room, a rental car to come back here to see one usher in the back and just say, could I just walk up there and just tell Brother Swagger one more? Just say, thank you, Brother Swagger.
I knew it.
Because I had a mandate from heaven in prayer. And when God talks to you in prayer, he won't let you alone. Now you want to hear the other part?
Yes, sir.
So I'm coming down here and get ready for that altar song, whatever it is. I don't know what it is. It's going to be a surprise to all of us.
You know, it's going to be a good one.
At least to me. So here's the other part of the story. I get my suitcase packed. I bring my one suit for my one service. For my one action to come up and say, thank you, Brother Swagger. The Brother Swagger that you talk about, it's prayer and the weakness of his flesh. Asleep and praise in the weakness of his flesh. Bill Bailey called me. I was already in the Atlanta airport. He said, Brother Tommy. I said, yes. He said, Brother Swagger was praying this morning. And Brother Swagger said, the Lord spoke to him and said, whoever that minister is that's coming with Bill Bailey, I want him to be on the message of the cross, Francis and Friends. I want him to record 3 programs, and I want him to sing on a Wednesday night.
We have the Lord told him.
Let's all stand together. What am I telling you? Things don't just happen.
No.
Joseph, can you read that
no
scripture?
No coincidence with the Lord. That's the thing.
I'm preaching, but I'm low and heavy in preaching.
He orchestrated.
Read what it says. Hebrews 5:7.
Who in the days of his...
Who in the days? You don't understand the old time way. You read the rest of it.
In the days of his flesh.
Of his flesh.
When he had offered up prayers.
When? Who? When he had offered up prayers. What kind of prayers were they? Tell me.
And supplications.
And supplications. That's presenting yourself as I'm helpless without you. If you don't help me,
Bless me, Lord.
Can't make it through.
With strong cry. With what? With strong cry. With strong cries. I'm telling you, there's more to this than putting your earphones on, listening to Kayla, and walking your dog.
No, that's right, Lord.
This is the most stubborn generation I've ever seen in my life. Every time I talk about prayer, they look at me and say, I can't get into that. This is the way I do it. Well, I want to see something happen.
I know that's right. Thank you, I do.
And it can only happen when we humble ourselves before God.
Yes.
If you got a prayer request, something on your heart, I want you to come quickly to the front of this altar. We're going to call on God together. What's the rest of it? With strong crying and tears. With strong crying and tears.
I know that well, Lord.
But to him who was
able.
Oh, God, there's the answer right there.
Well, I say I know that. Still can't get better.
Must believe that he is. That he's a rewarder of them. Come on, let's fill it up. It's a mix tonight. Let's just shock the devil tonight. I'm facing building a church for 18 million. I've got a deadline of June the 10th.
I believe we got it with you.
What are you doing? All of the marketing people say, who do you know this? Do you know this one? Do you know that one?
I know that's right. I'm believing with you.
I said, Lord, morning, noon, and night. Because if my Jesus prayed, tell me again.
But to him who was able to save.
Before that, tell me how he prayed again.
When he had offered up prayers and supplications.
Offered up prayers!
And supplications.
Oh, God! Offered up prayers! You think you're better than the Son of God? He emptied himself and made up no reputation. All this little pretty stuff is all right. But Jesus, tell me again.
Strong prayers and supplications.
Strong prayers. Woo! I'm challenging you here tonight. Some of you, most of the time when you call people up like this, they stand and just look at you. I want you to scare yourself. I want you to act like nobody's here. You close the blinds. And if you don't know what to pray, then just say the words to Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound.
I want you to
hear your voice. I want you to get used to opening up your mouth and hearing your voice. I want the devil to get used to hearing your voice. I want angels to get used to hearing your voice. Because I believe with all my heart. I don't know if I'm going to be a part of it, but I will come and visit. Because I believe that this place is getting ready to blast with a revival. And I want to come down to visit when it happens.
You know you invited.
Got the message of the cross and don't get any greater than that.
I know that's right, Lord. Thank you.
I want you to hear yourself. Tell me a little more.
With strong crying and tears.
With strong crying and tears.
Unto him who was able to save.
Unto him who was able to save.
Look at the children, Lord. If they hands to you. Look at this one. Hands to save you.
I tell you what, America is about that close to revival. But you got to do it the Bible way.
Lord, yeah.
The preaching of the word drives me to prayer. Prayer produces holiness.
Yes.
Holiness has preceded every revival that ever swept this earth. And hope and revival always brings in the harvest. Woo! If it don't bring in the loss, it's not a revival. It's just a good party. Hallelujah. Let's pray right now. Father, in the name of Jesus. Come on. Open your mouth.
Look at the children, Lord.
Remember, if you don't know what to say,
crying out to
you.
Look at this
one.
Crying out to say.
And if you don't know what to say,
we
you
love.
Can say, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch. You that
that
are watching
so
by the internet, you that are watching on television, you that are watching by your iPads or whatever, however you're watching.
watching, I want you, if you're in a place, I want you to say, God, well, listen to it. It's coming in this house right now. Come on, it's starting. It's starting. It's starting. Hashibahika. Hallelujah. Get used to hearing your voice. Get used to hearing your voice. And you know what else is terrifying? It's when you step out of your natural language into that unknown tongue. He has no idea what you're saying. Oh, God. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Go ahead, Brother Robin. Glory to God. Open up your voice. Call on the Lord. In the name of Jesus, God, we're believing for an outpouring of the Spirit of God. I'm asking you, Lord, to let our prayer go forth this instant.
Smell to his nostrils. Glory, thank you. And everyone sings it like Pastor, but go ahead. You love it. I put that on when I'm out and about. Repeat, repeat.
Please.
Lord Jesus, thank you. I see.
Jesus, Lord, we ask that you would touch our viewing audience, wherever in the world that they are, whatever the need and the circumstance of their life that they're facing. We pray that what Brother Bates preached tonight would come into their heart, their mind, their spirit, and they would offer up that prayer of incense. Let it go up to heaven. And Lord, we intercede for them right now. They are sick in body. Those that need a touch in their finances. Those that have children that are in rebellion. Those that have children that are battling addictions. Families that have been torn apart and they need restoration and reconciliation. Lord, we're asking right now through the power of the Holy Spirit that you would go out to minister to them. In Jesus' name we pray. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise tonight. Bring up boxes. Did we enjoy that tonight?
Oh, yes, Lord.
Hallelujah, we enjoy that. Thank you, Brother Bates. We want you to be generous to the servant of the Lord, and the Lord will bless you in your giving. If you make out a check, make it out to Family Worship Center. But the offering box is right here, so come on up, drop in your gift. We'll see you Sunday morning.
Well, that song for a child like that. I am happy all the day. At the cross, where birds fall, I burn up my heart, run away. It was what? It was there by faith.
I received my sound. And
now I am happy all the day. We know you've been blessed.
Located in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, at Jimmy Swagger Ministries. Those three services.